a little chat about menopause. And today I've got an expert who I'm really excited to have online, Dr. Louise Newson. And lots of you, whenever I've talked about menopause before, have mentioned her name. So I got in touch with Louise and I said, look, can you come and chat? Because I think it's nice to have an expert closer to home. A lot of my experts live in America and around the world. And I think that having a fantastic GP who's also trustee of the menopause charity and, you know, devotes her practice to helping with the education and treatment of hormonal and menopausal issues. And I think, I hope by the end of today and this chat, that you will feel better equipped perhaps to be talking to your GP and knowing the right questions to ask. Hello, everybody. Nisha.
Yes.
I've got Janice Newton. Hello, Janice. Saying hello. I've got people coming on. So I think we've got the questions coming in, which is great.
Amazing.
Brilliant. Already 1,000 people are watching us. So wonderful. And we've got lots of people also from Australia, because that's going to be interesting. And I will get Louise on now. So let's welcome Dr. Louise Newson.
Hello. Hi.
Hello, my dear. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Now, we've got a big audience today, Louise. So the reason I, in a way, do things internationally is we've got Singapore, we've got Australia, we've got everyone. And there's definitely going to be people closer to home. But as I said, that when I've done my menopause chats before, I've always had your name come up. So I'm really excited that you're here today to talk to us and to have an exchange of opinions and the way that menopause in some instances is not treated perhaps in a way that we would like every woman to feel that they could get advice on. We've already, you know, tons of people saying, you know, I want to ask hormonal testing, how do I do it? We're going to come to, I know there's going to be a ton of questions. And Nisha, I don't know if I can scroll up and down the questions like I normally can. They are coming thick and fast. So we'll get to them. So do leave your questions. And what we're going to do through this is just take time out, Louise, and go through some of those questions that are coming up that we can see repeated. And Nisha, you might want to say some of them if they're going around too quickly. So Louise, I'm going to start off with, I want to ask you a question here. How many women who are in a menopausal state do you think are mistreated or misdiagnosed, or just are not on the right program?
The vast majority, which is really sad, because the menopause is a natural process. We will all go through it if we live long enough. And the average age is 51, but there's a lot of women in their 20s, 30s. My youngest patient's 19, who's menopausal. Mm-hmm. So we will all go through it, and it's a natural process, but most people don't realise what the symptoms are. And more importantly, most people don't realise what the health risks are. So we know in the UK, it's around between 10 and 14% of women take HRT. Mm-hmm. Now, for the majority of women, the benefits of taking HRT outweigh any risks. So why is that? You know, if I'd come from outer space and I was told there was a treatment that replaced hormone levels, that was derived from the yams, a root vegetable, that was the same structure as the hormones we produce, it will, when you get the right dose and type, it will improve all your menopausal symptoms, and it will also reduce your risk of heart disease, diabetes, osteoporosis, and dementia.
Yeah, we're solving that as a drug.
You'd be saying, why aren't we all on it? And I'd also tell you it was very cheap. So you'd think, well, why? And I, you know, this is why my whole life is about the menopause, because I'm incredibly frustrated for women, that women are being denied it for the wrong reasons, because we as women, but also the media, and also me as a healthcare professional, have been fed wrong information. And what you have to do is look at the evidence. And we've got evidence, which we can discuss, but that's what's really important. So women can have the right choice and make the right decisions about their menopause.
I think it's very difficult sometimes to look at those symptoms. And I think we could start with the symptoms, because they are, you know, They come up earlier. You know, Louise, we briefly discussed, but I didn't appreciate that, because I'd done 16 rounds of IVF. I expect to get menopause at 55, and I got it earlier because really I kind of, for want of a better word, run out of eggs. Yeah. But you know, my kind of system just had stopped producing eggs. which made me go into it. So because it was not expected, you know, I wasn't looking out for it.
I think none of us do, Trinny. You know, I'm a menopause specialist, and some of you might have read my story, but, you know, when I was in my mid-40s, I was developing the menopausedoctor.co.uk website, and I was working really hard. I just started setting up my clinic, which, as you know, is private because I can't get a job in the NHS. So I was trying different avenues to start working, and I was just feeling dreadful. I had back-to-back migraines, muscle joint pains, feeling irritable. My husband, even his breathing was just the most annoying thing ever. I hated everything. Yeah. I had this demon in my brain telling me how awful things were, and it allowed me to be so rude and so horrible and tearful, and I couldn't sleep. And I thought it was just because I was working too hard. Yet I'm every night writing content for my website saying the common symptoms of the menopause are irritability, poor sleep, migraines, joint pains, muscle aches. But it wasn't me. I wasn't thinking about myself. And it was only when someone pointed out, my daughter actually said, I think you need your period because you're so moody. I then thought, goodness, I haven't had a period for a few months. Of course, I'm perimenopausal, which is this time before the menopause. So once our periods have stopped, it's pretty obvious. Or once our ovaries are removed, if people have their ovaries removed, obviously they become menopausal. But for most women like myself, you just get this gradual onset of symptoms, and they're not always there every day. So some days you're fine, other days you're dreadful. You might have months of feeling great, months of feeling awful. And we always just blame other things. And this is the problem also, is that if I'd gone to my GP, you see, I thought I had lymphoma, a type of cancer, because I was getting night sweats and tired. Mm-hmm. And I said to my husband, I can't go to the doctor. I don't want a blood test. I'm too busy doing my menopause work. Whereas if I'd gone, that doctor in that snapshot might have said, oh, let's do a blood test to make sure we haven't got lymphoma.
It was incredible. You were doing your menopause work, and it's still difficult for you to recognize your symptoms. I think it's a very good point. I just want to stick on for a second, Louise, because, you know, sometimes we can look back and because time has been pushed into a smaller amount, we can look at everything and see it all retrospectively. Mm. But I think when you're in it, you can't. Yeah. Like, I never had really night sweats.
Yeah.
And I have spoken to, you've spoken to thousands of women, but I have my own analysis on night sweats. And I think it's to do with where you deposit your fat, which part of your upper or lower body, and the size of your breasts.
Mm.
And very oddly, I just think that there's a relationship, and I don't know how medically that could be true. But, you know, when you talk about the irritability, and I'd like to go, if we can, straight on to, I think one thing that you and I agree is one of the worst things around diagnosis in the UK and around the world, which is, here's an antidepressant.
Yeah, totally. Totally. And I had no idea. So when I was doing my menopause work as a GP, people would come and see me, I would treat them very quickly and they'd feel better, and isn't that great? And then I opened up my menopause clinic, and I literally did it because a few of my friends who are a little bit older than me were saying, oh, I've got all these symptoms and my periods have stopped. And I said, well, you need some HRT. No, my doctor's giving me some citalopram, some venlafaxine, some sertraline. And I'm saying, why? I've never given that in my life. There's no evidence for giving that to.
Yeah. Oh, hang on. Nisha?
Hi.
Something's happened.
I think Louise has got slightly poor connection.
Okay, can you just text her? So
yeah.
Are you still catching me, ladies?
Yeah, they can hear you.
You're catching me. So I'm taking down all your questions and we will go through them all. And we will be talking about elements and things we're going to be talking about, antidepressant, weight gain, the connection between cancer and HRT. If you're in your 70s, you know, can you, you know, a lot of people think, I've taken HRT for such a long time, I have to stop. So what are the conditions by which you have to say, actually, I should stop HRT? Can you hear me, by the way? You're all still there. Great. Thank you. I think that there's quite a few people in America talking about having endocrinologists and going to see an endocrinologist directly. And I think that's something that it's easier in America to go and see specialists directly because everyone in America generally is on health insurance. Sorry, Louise, I'm just going through some of the questions whilst you were coming back in there. But so I'm just saying what we're going to go through, darling, antidepressants, weight gain, cancer and HRT connections, when you're 70 coming off it, about going to see an endocrinologist. So that's, I'm just writing down for us so we have those categories. But staying now on antidepressants, so we both agree, and I think many ladies here will say they have gone to see somebody who's just actually then given them that. And do you think that's because there is a suggestion here that the more you can recognize your symptoms, the more you can properly explain to your doctor so that they're not just taking this kind of, oh, I'm feeling anxious and low, and just treating that?
Yeah, so I think there's two things. I think there's that people are only realizing the small number of symptoms and they're not grouping together all the other symptoms that are related. Yeah. So, you know, I did a lot of work with West Midlands Police, and we found that 78% of women didn't recognize their symptoms as being menopausal because they hadn't got the right information. And so once you have the right information, you know they're your symptoms, it's easier.
But okay. Can we just then?
Yeah.
I love to do this, chunk size pieces, Louise. Okay. The following in your mind are the symptoms, and I'd love you to say if there's an order they come in or if you think they can come differently, who get some of them, who which must get all of them.
Yeah.
What do
What we need to think about when we think about symptoms is that estrogen, the main female hormone, affects every single cell in our body. So every single area in our body can be affected by symptoms when we have low estrogen levels.
Yeah.
So if you even work from the top of your body, your hair gets affected, it can dry, it can break more easily, it can fall out, become thinner. Think of your brain, you can get headaches, migraines, but also you can get the mood problems, you can get the brain fog, the concentration problems, the irritability, the anxiety. A lot of people think they've got dementia because they can't remember. We need estrogen to help our brains to work. And then you can think about your eyes. People can get dry eyes, itchy eyes. Think about your ears. You can get tinnitus. You can get balance problems, dry mouth.
It's all from the level reducing, which is a symptom.
And then it affects our heart, so we can get palpitations, we can get breathing problems, it can affect our gut, so people get irritable bowel type syndromes, it can affect our muscles and our joints,
just estrogen still.
It's all, estrogen is so important, it can affect our immune system, so COVID's more likely when we're postmenopausal and don't have hormones in our body, but people can get...
Is it always, Louise, the first hormone that's depleted? Is there a reason by which there's a depletion between the progesterone and the testosterone and the estrogen?
Yeah, so the three main hormones in our body are estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, as in the female hormones. We've got lots of other hormones in our body. But estrogen and testosterone are the hormones that we really need. Now, progesterone, we need to regulate our periods. And if a woman is taking HRT and has her womb, she needs a type of progesterone. But the good hormones, if you like, that help us to function and also improve our future health are estrogen and testosterone. And interestingly, we produce more testosterone than estrogen before our menopause. Some women find their testosterone reduces before their estrogen starts reducing. So there are some perimenopausal women whose periods haven't really changed much, but they're starting to feel they've got low energy.
Let's just talk about, if you don't have much testosterone, what are those symptoms?
So low energy, reduced stamina, brain fog, just that sort of flatness, that joie de vie has gone, really. Muscle aches and pains as well. And so some people find their testosterone goes first, other people their estrogen goes first, or some people it's both together.
Yeah.
If you have your ovaries removed, most of your estrogen and testosterone just goes overnight.
I mean, all of mine, I have to say, in my reading, the first time I went to see somebody, and I went to a clinic in London, which after 2 or 3 years, I realized was not the right clinic for me, but my levels were all nearly at zero.
Yeah. And it's
not noticed it for quite a long time. I think if I, you know, maybe I'd been perimenopausal since I was 40, you know, because then I would have had those 16 IVFs because I finished them at 40, 41.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that when I look back now and I think my late 40s, it's when I got separated from my husband. It's when everything in my life was irritating me, but because there were outside factors, I think it's harder in life to separate what are the external factors which are exasperating what is internally happening anyway.
It's very, very hard. And there isn't a blood test to diagnose the menopause or perimenopause. There is not a single blood test. So no one listening should be going off having a blood test. Or I read something the other night about a urine test for menopause. You make the diagnosis on a history of listening about the symptoms. And what you need to do is to download a symptom questionnaire. So there's one on the website, or there's one on my Balance app. So
there's menopause.com.
Menopause.co.uk.
Menopause.co.uk.
Questionnaire, or on the Balance app, you can download and it will ask you. And so, if you have symptoms and your periods have changed in nature or frequency, or your periods have stopped, then it's most likely that you are having some changing hormone levels. Mm. You know, and it's impossible for me as a doctor to say how many of these symptoms are related. But if you replace those missing hormones, you can see what's left and what might be due to a disease or something else, for example. So it's actually very easy. The hardest thing is recognizing the symptoms.
Symptom one, I'm going to now just go on to some quick fires because I just think there's so many coming through. And I just want to, hang on, how do I go? I'm trying to go back, Nisha, to the previous questions.
Scroll on the right side.
Okay. I have not got a scroll on the right hand side. Okay. All right. So I'm gonna have to do, if you want to leave your question again, but Nisha, have you got some quick fire questions you've taken down?
Yes.
And repeating the symptoms, do go back and watch, but symptoms that Louise has mentioned are hair loss, your mood changing, sort of brain fog, which is you just can't remember, memory loss. You might have dry mouth. You might have tinnitus. It's not a bosom related problem. And low energy levels, a reduction of your kind of stimulation, et cetera. But I want to talk that once you get to a stage where maybe you're recognizing some of these things, would you actually, Louise, put in that weight gain? Or would you put in weight gain? Yeah. And how do you think, because I know many women who believe you do not need to go through a weight gain situation during menopause and other things might be triggering weight gain, but do you believe that there is a pure symptom of, you know, it's contributing factors because you don't have the adrenals working?
There's several reasons why people can put on weight during the perimenopause and menopause. And sometimes if you just look at the symptoms, reduced motivation, low energy, lack of self-esteem, sugar cravings can be very common. So a lot of people can't be bothered to cook. They can't be bothered to move and exercise. They just feel rubbish. They comfort eat to try and make them feel better, or they drink more wine to try and numb their symptoms. So obviously lifestyle changes can have an effect. Yeah. But a lot of women say they notice a midline spread, if you like, and they're not changing anything. They're still exercising, still eating the same. So, but the metabolism changes without estrogen. So without estrogen, you start to get this metabolic syndrome. You don't metabolize insulin in the same way. Your body also wants estrogen. We are designed to have estrogen. And the only way the body can make estrogen is a very weak estrogen in fat cells. So if we produce more fat cells, our body will get a little bit more estrogen, and that will help. It's useless estrogen. It's not very good, but it's the best the body can do. So lots of people put on weight, and actually having the right dose and type of HRT will help reduce weight, not only because people feel better, they're more likely to exercise and eat better, but the metabolic processes are reversed. So people don't need to, the body doesn't need to make these stupid fat cells that have weak estrogen in them, because you're replacing it with the right dose and type of HRT.
But I think it is, as you say, that combination. It's the diet, but it's that, you know, when we feel flat mentally, we all know what our triggers are. You know, we all know what we do. And for me, I do eat sugar. You know, I'll go and 4 chocolate bars a day and things like that. And I think it's just, it can't convert. Sugar stays sugary and does not have the ability with our, you know.
But we also know that we've got really good studies, haven't we, about lack of sleep. So if sleep is poor, people are more likely to put on weight. And a lot of women, it's the biggest thing people thank me for in the clinic, is they get their sleep back because their hormones are balanced. Our hormones, estrogen and testosterone, are really important for sleep.
Hmm. People saying, you know, I gain weight because I cannot work out because I'm getting injured. I have got Fen tennis elbows. I still have my periods. I'm 46. That's quite a singular one, Marika. But I can just, you know, you talked earlier, Louise, and what was interesting is I have done every type of drug there is for menopause. You know, I've done full HRT. I've done, you know, just kind of gentle, a little sort of more organic-y kind of stuff. I've done sage. I've done cherry night powder of sweats. I've done everything. But in the, you see, there it is. I've got fog brain. I was just about to come up with something really good here. And I had fog brain moment. Where was I heading? Can't remember where I was heading. Fuck it. Excuse me.
Well, I think what we need to think about all of this is there are lots of women that say, well, I don't want hormones. I want something natural. And you have
Let's talk about the difference, Louise, because I think it's grey.
It's important because I think you have to think about why you're taking hormones. And a lot of people think they've got to wait till their symptoms are really bad. And it's only if their symptoms are really bad, let's talk about HRT. But actually, we don't need to wait till our symptoms are bad. We don't even need to wait till we're menopausal. We can start HRT when we're perimenopausal. You know, no one can
graduate that. Just stop that. Because you come out with some amazing statements. And it's just very interesting because there are many, I know many GPs who say, well, you're not menopausal, so I'm not giving it to you. And that could be a budget constraint with that local cut, whatever it could be. But it's, as you say, it's not that expensive, HRT.
No, it's not at all. It's dirt cheap. But the problem is that HRT is licensed for menopausal women. But the perimenopause is when hormones first start reducing. So if we top up the low hormones with some hormone replacement therapy, that's the best time to do it. Because once our hormone levels really decline, not only often, not always, symptoms worsen, but then we've got these health risks. So there are about 20-25% of women won't get many symptoms at all. They'll breeze through the menopause and they'll think, right, I've done it. But actually those women are 5 times more likely to have a heart attack. They're more likely to have osteoporosis, more likely to have diabetes and dementia. And it's really important because we live so long. You know, if we were having this conversation, Trinny, 100 years ago, we would die quite soon after our menopause. So, yeah, it would be a shame for some of us, but it wouldn't matter so much. But now the average age of the menopause is 51. The average age of death in the UK is 82. So that's 30 years of trying to slow our bodies without hormones. And that's why 1 in 2 women develop osteoporosis. You know, the most common cause of death is cardiovascular disease, heart disease. Mm-hmm. Taking HRT reduces the risk of heart disease by 50%.
It's unbelievable.
You know, it's more effective than taking a statin or a blood pressure lowering drug.
I think this is the other thing, because there's a lot of comments on this, Louise, and I feel very strongly about, I have one view I take, but, you know, there's a lot of people who might say, oh, HRT, grow old gracefully, you know, these are things that, you know, our body isn't wanting to do this. But your comment earlier is we are living a lot longer than we used to. Mm. So it's about supporting our body. It's about giving. And also, to me, HRT is in no way at all a vanity matrix.
Not at all.
It's an energy, life force, want to feel my best matrix. I don't want achy joints. I don't want to feel tired and flat and foggy brain. I don't want that as long as I'm alive.
No, I think, you know, it's so important. Every day could be our last, couldn't it? So we want to make the most. We only got our own bodies, we have to look after them and we want to keep healthy. And so I could stop my HRT today and I might not have any symptoms. They might have already gone out of my body, but I'm really scared of osteoporosis. So one of the reasons I will take HRT forever is because I don't want to be the 1 in 2 women who develop osteoporosis. I've seen so many women with osteoporosis of their spine, really affecting them, a lot of pain, can't digest food properly, can't breathe properly, can't walk with their Zimmer, you know, but I also don't want dementia or heart disease. And of course I might get any of these things, but I'm less likely to get it if I take hormone replacement. And it's the same way if I had an underactive thyroid gland, I could survive without thyroxine. I'd be quite slow and I'd put on weight and I wouldn't be able to think properly, but I wouldn't do that. I would just take thyroxine. And the reason that everyone is scared about HRT is because of this whole breast cancer risk. And I'm happy to talk about that and why there's been so many misconceptions.
I'd like to go on to that. Now my fog brain's lifted because so many people have asked the same question, Louise, but two elements of the same question. One is women who are, I have a lot of women older who maybe didn't have such a breadth of knowledge when they were going through it. They never taken HRT. Is 65 too old? Hold that thought for a second, because I also, in that same thing, want to ask you, you know, if you start taking it at in your 50s, do you have to give it up at some stage, or can you continue to take it? Because there's a few women here who are saying, you know, I stopped taking because I'd taken it so long. It was the same that they'd attached to, I've been on the pill too long, I must stop it, with just reading snapshots of life without realizing what's the medical knowledge behind these. So those two questions, is it ever too old to start, and how many years can you take it for?
So firstly, no one's ever too old for anything, are they? And there's an article, actually, one of the leaflets on my menopausedoctor.co.uk website, if you go under resources, leaflets, there's something about starting HRT when you're older, because there are a lot of women that have been told, because of the misinformation, they can't take HRT.
Yeah.
See a lot of women in their 60s, 70s. We had someone in my clinic recently.
Yeah, 73. Is it too old? What is HRT?
No.
I love that from Donna. Let's tell her. Let's change her life.
So, yeah, HRT we prescribe now is a lot safer than it was 20 years ago. So we have estrogen through the skin. There's no risk of clot or stroke. We have the natural progesterone, which has never been proven to be associated with the risk of breast cancer. So women can start it, and you still, even very low doses of estrogen help protect our bones. So there, people can start it when they're older. And also, we can take it forever. So the current guidance is the majority of women, the benefits outweigh any risks. For most women, there aren't actually any risks. But we can take it as long as these benefits outweigh the risks. And there are so many health benefits, we can take it. So the same way, if you had diabetes and you were needing insulin, you wouldn't stop insulin at the age of 60, 70, 80. You would carry on taking it.
Yeah,
and that's exactly the same with hormones. And a lot of doctors think you have to stop when you're 60, or you only take it for 10 years. And you need to push back and say, no, I've read the guidelines. There's the NICE guidance in the UK, the National Institute of Health and Care Excellence, or there's the International Menopause Society guidelines, which were in 2006.
So I'm just going to repeat that, because I think that is a big one. If your doctor is saying you've been on it 20 years, you can't be on it anymore, fight back. Go and NICE and the other ones you've mentioned, Louise, and we'll try and put some of this information too at the end, Nisha. Are we going to try and do that? Yeah, great. So we'll try and those key points. Now, there are certain people who maybe cannot. Yes, two things. I want to say I find HRT, I think a lot of women feel it's a drug called HRT. And I just think, can we peel back and just say HRT means hormone replacement therapy? And there are many different kind of hormone replacement therapies. But can we just talk about the different ways you can do HRT?
Yeah, totally. So it is only three letters. And the problem is they're such dreadful three letters. Everyone thinks HRT equals breast cancer. They don't even know what it is.
Yeah.
So there are different types. There are different doses. I've already said we've got the three main hormones, estrogen, testosterone, and progesterone. So estrogen, it used to be prescribed from derived from pregnant mare's urine. We don't prescribe that, thankfully, anymore. But it comes as a tablet or a gel or a patch or a spray. The best and the safest way is having it as the spray or the gel or a patch, because it goes through the skin into the bloodstream. So there's no risk of clot at all or stroke. It's very safe, and you can change the dose. So a lot of women, especially younger women, need higher doses to replace what their body should be producing otherwise.
That's so interesting that younger women has higher doses.
Yeah.
At that stage normally. So people going into early menopause.
Yes. Yeah, so women in their 30s, 20s, 30s, 40s often need higher doses because you're trying to replace what they naturally would otherwise be producing. So up to the age of 51, the average age of the menopause, HRT is really safe because you're just replacing. And in fact, it's safer than taking the combined oral contraceptive pill, because in the pill, it's a synthetic estrogen and it's a tablet. So there's a small risk of clot, only small, but it's synthetic estrogen as well. Whereas this is really natural. It's derived from yams, the root vegetable. It's exactly the same structure. If you analyzed it in a laboratory, it's exactly the same hormone as a hormone we produce ourselves. So it has all these health benefits with it.
So Estorel.
Estradiol, yes.
So then going back there, you're saying hormone replacement therapy it's generic. So some people early on might just need one of the hormones replaced. Depending on how you're analyzed in where you're at, somebody might say you should have both. And that's so subjective on how good your doctor, endocrinologist, which is a hormone expert, gynecologist really is not somebody, you might have a very friendly gynecologist who can advise you, but they are generally going up to, I don't know what you think, Louise, but it's like when people are saying where to get the advice from.
Yeah, and this really varies. So traditionally it has been gynecologists. I'm not sure why, because it's when our periods stop. But so gynecologists have, primary care physicians, so GPs, should know about the menopause. A lot of nurses actually are really good with the menopause. We've got a pharmacist that works with us who's very good as well. And do you know what? Every doctor or physician or healthcare professional that sees an adult woman has to know about the menopause, and they don't, and it's scandalous. But we need to change this. But finding someone who's had some education about the menopause to talk to is really important. So
can I talk here about a lot of women here have had a form of cancer, Louise, and they're saying, but one comment here really got to me, which is my oncologist said, you're lucky to be alive from your cancer, so you really don't have a right to complain about your menopausal symptoms.
Right, yes. Yeah. So I think we need to talk about this. So I think with cancer, women with cancer are still going to go through a menopause.
Yeah.
And actually, now with childhood cancers, treatment is so much better. More people will be living with the menopause than they will with, problems with their cancer. So there are different types of cancer. There are some types of cancer that are estrogen receptor positive. Now, most cancers aren't. So, for example, cervical cancer, bone cancer, bladder cancer, none of these are reactive and respond to hormones. So most women, if you find out what type of cancer you've had, you can still safely take HRT. So it leaves women who have had an estrogen receptor positive cancer. And these are often breast cancers, but it can be some other types of ovarian or endometrial cancers. And they
find that all breast cancer.
No, so some breast cancers are estrogen receptor negative. And okay. So those women can safely take HRT usually, but a lot of doctors still don't realize that.
Okay, so let's just slow down on that one, Louise, because it's a big thing to
totally.
It's so really good to understand it, because there's that sort of blanketing, you've had breast cancer, you can't.
No, absolutely. Or even you've had cancer. I saw someone in my clinic who's 34 and she's had cervical cancer, and told she could never have HRT, and she'd given up her job and was suicidal because no one would help her. So if you've had a cancer that is not estrogen receptor positive, you should be able to take HRT.
Yeah.
If you've had a cancer that's estrogen receptor positive, such as a breast cancer, then it's looking at you as an individual, not as a group of women who've had breast cancer. Mm-hmm. So there are different types, there are different stages, there are different times. So, for example, I saw a lady yesterday in my clinic who'd had breast cancer 5 years ago. It was a very small cancer. It hadn't spread anywhere. She'd had 5 years of tamoxifen. She'd had bilateral mastectomy, so both her breasts had been removed, and she'd had chemotherapy. Yet she was on her knees with menopausal symptoms. She had very dark thoughts. She'd had a lot of the symptoms we talked about. She couldn't walk down the stairs easily because her muscles and joints were so stiff and sore. Mm-hmm. Yet her oncologist said, no way, I forbid you to have HRT. And if you have it, you'll have to sign a disclaimer. Now, what we need to do as doctors is, firstly, I've already said, we need to look at evidence. Now, there is no evidence that women taking HRT do worse when they take HRT if they've had an estrogen receptor positive cancer. There is some evidence that women do better, because estrogen used to be a treatment for estrogen receptor positive cancers, and it can kill some of the cancer cells.
But you said at the beginning that if you have an estrogen receptor positive result, you might want to avoid, but if it was a negative result, you can.
So I'm saying what you can and can't do from the available evidence. So if you've had an estrogen receptor negative cancer, there's no evidence at all that HRT is any more harmful than it is for someone like me who's not had a cancer.
Yeah.
If you've had an estrogen receptor positive cancer, we don't have any really good robust studies. We've got lots of studies that show that women do better if they have had an estrogen receptor positive cancer and take HRT. We've got two that show women do slightly worse, and one was stopped early because people were worried about HRT. But if you look at the numbers, it's very small.
Yeah, I think this is Louise. This is very relevant to a lot of the questions and statements women are leaving right now. Is I'm scared of the concept of HRT, so I haven't gone on it. And then they're going on to say, talk about all the symptoms they have, and that I mustn't take it. There's this real like Chinese wall between can consider it.
I think what we need to do is this estrogen receptor positive group. There's I've got some podcasts on my resources section, so listen to those. There's some, it's number 51 and 52 are really good. So listen to them.
I think that's quite a specific thing.
It's very specific. And all I'm really trying to say is there's never a no. There's never a no. You have to see someone who understands.
I've got a few quick fire questions, Louise, because there's so many questions coming in. Otherwise, we'll be overwhelmed because I'm going to ask you at the end, can we help to answer some? But these are just, you know, things that are thrown out there and they're not quite true, but they become, you know, it's that sort of folklore becomes fact. So there's quite a few comments here saying I've no one take HRT because they're not regulated hormones. You can't predict the dosage. Okay. You can't get the dosages right. So I just want to open that up and say actually you can and why that statement might be misinformation.
So let's talk about that and I really want to talk about this whole breast cancer risk.
Yeah.
Because that's really important, if that's okay. So we've already said estrogen, patches, gels, sprays, tablets. These are all regulated licensed products, certainly in the UK. Everyone should be taking licensed, regulated estrogen. They shouldn't be having unregulated bioidentical stuff. Progesterone is needed if women still have got their womb. So you can have the natural progesterone as a capsule. Some people choose to have a Mirena coil, and there are some progestogens. If a woman's had a hysterectomy, they don't usually need a progesterone. And then there's testosterone, which we've already said women produce more testosterone than estrogen before the menopause. It's another really important hormone for women, yet it's not licensed for women across the world, which is absolutely scandalous. We're not allowed our own hormone back. So the way around it, we can prescribe a regulated testosterone. And in the UK, we can prescribe the men's testosterone at lower levels, or we have a cream which is made and regulated in Australia, which we are allowed to prescribe privately. So license doesn't mean it's not safe, it's just the indication for it. So we prescribe a lot of children's medications that aren't licensed, but we know they're safe from the evidence. So there's a difference between licensing and regulation. But important products are regulated because there are a lot of people that have compounded bioidentical hormones which are neither licensed nor regulated.
And I think it's very, very important, and we can't reiterate enough, that you get it from a recommended medical practitioner. Do not go online searching for hormones, because and I think like the ones I take, Louise, you know, I know the proportion in that estrogel or in those different things of it is regulated, the amounts, the dosages are there. It's not like taking St. John's wort and not knowing how much natural is in it.
It's very important to know there are different doses, there are different types, there are different, but it's really important. And this is available on the NHS as well, I must say. It's not about a private expense. It costs the NHS about £4 a month to prescribe HRT.
Could you repeat the name of the testosterone from Australia, please, Louise?
So it's called Androfem.
And
we're hoping, and certainly one of the things I want the charity to do is really campaign for testosterone to be licensed. It's just disgusting. We're not allowed. Can you imagine a man surviving without testosterone? It just wouldn't happen, would it?
I know, it wouldn't happen. I mean, I've had also boosted testosterone shots, you know, when I've really been totally floored by, you know, maybe work and everything. And you know, I need testosterone. I think women run differently on different hormones too, Louise. There's an evidence of what kind of woman we are and what hormones also our body responds well to.
Yeah, and the big thing about any menopause guidelines is women should have individualized care. So it's not the same HRT for every person, and it's not the same dose for every person. And some women don't need or miss testosterone. I can't function without it. My brain wouldn't function. I always had so much brain fog and forgetfulness. But and that's why you need to have individualized help. But so we know there are lots of benefits taking HRT. If you have the right dose and type, then your symptoms will improve. But also, more importantly for me, is that your future health will improve. So why isn't everyone taking HRT? And I'll tell you why, and we know, don't we? Because people are scared of breast cancer risk. Mm. So if I could just spend a couple of minutes saying this whole breast cancer risk. And it's come from a study that came out in 2002, the Women's Health Initiative study, the WHI study, multi-billion dollar study in America. And it should never really have been done because it was looking at the wrong type of women. But we've got it. But what happened was, when it came out, it was misreported to the media, which should never have happened. And they said there's increased risk of breast cancer in women taking HRT. What they didn't do is analyze the data properly, which has since been analyzed. So we know from this study that's been analyzed properly and subsequent studies that if a woman has estrogen only HRT, so she's had a hysterectomy, she's not taking progesterone, she has a 25% lower risk of breast cancer. And I'm going to say that again. Estrogen is associated with a lower risk of breast cancer. Not only a lower risk of getting it, but a lower risk of dying from breast cancer. So estrogen is a really good bit.
Yeah, so I think I can't reiterate it enough. And this is debunking myth. Yeah. And I remember that because I have a friend actually who is in the healthcare industry in America. She told me that when the report came out, she said, "Trinny, this report is so wrong." And I remember people were outraged by the way it had been taken up.
Yeah, so this was 2002, so it's now 2000. We've got 18 years follow-up.
And also 18 years of not being able to debunk a myth. Anyway, I want to just go back to, so hormone replacement therapy, it sits that you can have specific individual hormones. Can we talk a bit about, because people say, well, what are bioidentical hormones, and are they body identical hormones or bioidentical hormones? But I just want to get clear that, you know, because there's people in this bigger, broader question, Louise, who would say, well, can't I just take a natural path, you know, of something versus HRT? Because they see HRT as this big fat pill, a natural path. And so I think it would be good to continue in that we've got the estrogel, we've got the different testosterone gels you can take or patches, but let's talk, what are bioidentical? What does it mean?
So why, when people were so scared, or they still are, about HRT, and they think it's all synthetic, derived from horse's yam, it's some horrible chemical, people were trying to find something more natural, if you like. Yeah. And so people went to these bioidentical clinics, and a lot of bioidentical clinics are not regulated. So it comes, they make it themselves without any regulation or licensing. And because of it's not a licensed medication, it's not under any quality control. So it's under as a food supplement. So I could make it in my clinic here and give it to you. And then I could make it again another week and it might be something slightly different. And some of these samples we have analyzed and they've been have different levels. Whereas you can imagine if I was making something that had to be regulated, it goes under really big quality control. But just because it's a regulated product doesn't mean it's not natural or it's not safe. And so we've moved on with our HRT, and the HRT we usually prescribe is body identical, which basically means it's the same structure as the hormones we produce ourselves. Exactly the same. It's not been modified in any way, like the contraceptive pill has.
Yeah.
It's the pure hormones, but it's regulated. So we know if I prescribe it to you today and I prescribe it to you in 2 months' time or 2 years' time, it's exactly the same. I know what the dose is, I know what the type is.
Yeah.
So that's really important. There's a lot of these compounded bioidentical clinics that are very expensive, and they say they'll match your hormones, they'll do blood tests, saliva tests. If it's very expensive, it won't be a regulated licensed hormone. So you have to ask yourself why you're taking that. You know, we have to also ask why are we not taking HRT? So I could take sage or red clover or something, and it might help my flushes or symptoms, but it won't help protect my heart from heart disease. It won't strengthen my bones. It won't help my brain and reduce my risk of dementia. So we have to look at it as a long-term hormone deficiency. If you have a
deficiency... But I think on that point, Louise, yeah. I might say, because I have long conversations with Shabir at Victoria Health, and there are women... And there are certain women with a really good endocrinologist and a oncologist, but who will say, actually, with this cancer that you have, you shouldn't. There are a few cancers where maybe you shouldn't because it will trigger, all right? So for those, it's like if somebody, because there's a lot of people here, Louise, saying, I can't take HRT, so what else can I take? Because they haven't got the full picture of the fact that maybe they might be able to. And for the lady who said, let Louise finish more about breast cancer. There are just so many questions here, and I know we only have seven. I need to kind of give everyone the subject matter of questions being answered.
There is a booklet on my website as well for women that have had cancer. The other thing that we haven't spoken about, Trinny, is vaginal dryness and urinary symptoms, because... Yeah. Vaginal dryness affects around 80% of women, yet only around 8% have treatment, which is absolutely shocking. And when I say vaginal dryness, it's not just painful when people have sex. A lot of women find it's less stretchy, it's less lubricated, so walking can be uncomfortable. I speak to a lot of women that can't wear underclothes, they can't wear jeans, they can't sit down, they can't ride a bike. And it happens because of the low estrogen, and there are local estrogen treatments. So estrogen is a pessary, a gel that you use in the vagina, or a ring. All these treatments are safe for every woman, including women that have had an estrogen receptor positive cancer. So that's not the same as HRT, the gels, the patches we've spoken about. This is vaginal, and it often helps with urinary symptoms as well. Yeah. It seeps through to the bladder, the pelvic floor.
And I think, Louise, on this note, I mean, my audience is all ages, but I think there is a chunk of women who have perhaps grown up in an area where they don't complain so much. And so I just want to talk to all those women who might feel, well, I just have to get used to it. It's a stage of life, is to actually say, you don't have to get used to it. And it could really, you know, I think as we go down the path of life, Louise, so many things can, you know, happen to our bodies that cause a little ache and pain here and there. But I'm 56 and I was, you know, on the top of a mountain in Scotland 3 or 4 months ago, because I just stopped taking my HRT, and I was, you know, I didn't realize, because it came rushing up on me, that incredibly achy joints, like so painful, like I was a much older woman. And now I've been back on them for 7 weeks and I haven't got one, you know. And just for those women who are suffering in silence, and I wanted really just address our ladies, and any of these symptoms we've mentioned, you're having them, do go and talk to your GP. Do go on to menopausedoctor.co.uk and get the right information. Do know the questions to ask, and do get help for your symptoms.
And I do think it's about thinking about our future health as well. We don't get any prizes for being menopausal. No one will give us a medal, or you don't get a telegram from the Queen to say you've been menopausal for 10 years. Well done.
And also for younger people watching, you know, that it's an interesting one on menopause, because I decided, Louise, we should do this on Facebook, because I felt it was a more relevant audience, because it's a slightly more sophisticated audience, I'm going to put it that way. But, you know, I've got like Nisha listening here, who's one of my team, and just going through any questions and stuff. And there are women, not necessarily that they've got symptoms yet, but I think also it's, you don't want any woman slightly young to think, oh my God, menopause, that sounds so dreadful.
Yeah.
And I think that's also just a shout out for those people watching thinking, you know, maybe it's going to come around in 10, 15 years.
Yeah, I think it's really important. And that's certainly one of the reasons that we developed this free app, Balance, so that I want every woman to download it, so then they can start to track their symptoms and get information early.
Yeah.
We see a lot of women like yourself who had fertility treatment. No one talked about their menopause. A lot of women with fertility problems don't have the same ovarian function. They're not churning out the same amount of hormones. So a lot of women can be topped up with hormones. They don't have to wait till their periods stop. They don't have to wait till they've given up the their job or their partner or thinking about giving up their life. They can do it earlier. We need to make the next generation of women like Nisha's age to have it as a really positive experience. You know, we shouldn't be doing this live Facebook session about the menopause because everyone should be replacing their hormones. We don't have one about hypothyroidism or about diabetes because people are cracking on with their lives, and that's what we should about the menopause.
There's a good question here from Dion. Are there any non-prescription things I can take now whilst I'm waiting for an appointment? You know, this is the thing of the time we live in, Louise, because you know, things like this are put on the back burner with that in England. This just applies to us in the UK, and maybe in countries like Melbourne would have had that for 7 months of lockdown, and New Zealand's been on a lockdown too. But what can, because we don't want a lady to be inspired by this and go racing off to a Chinese site getting some bad hormone replacement. We want them to be able to get properly diagnosed and get those patches. But what can they do in that situation? Because I think there's quite a few women who might feel that getting off this chat that they would like to take action now and
Do you know what? It's really, really hard, and it really saddens me that so many women can't get the right help. And it's looking at which symptoms are affecting you the most. And there are some short-term measures, you know, even lifestyle. And this is really hard when you're menopausal, but thinking about eating the right types of food, cutting down on processed food, not eating sugar, thinking about probiotics, trying to improve your gut health is really important. Thinking about measures to help your sleep. If you're drinking alcohol, eating spicy foods, that can trigger some symptoms.
Yeah.
You know, menopause can be done as a remote consultation, and it should be done by GPs and nurses. And I'm doing a lot of work in the UK with NHS England to really try and get it on the agenda.
So it is about being more demanding to your...
And certainly, if you download our app Balance, which is free, it will create a health report. So if you do that and create this health report, you can print it off, email it to your GP, surgery in advance, or take it to your GP. You know, your GP will see your symptoms, see your period, see other things about your health, and that will save 2 or 3 minutes of a very precious 10-minute consultation.
Yeah. And also puts them in a position of taking you more seriously.
Yeah, definitely. And I know it's really hard. I get really nervous seeing my GP because I think I'm wasting their time and they're really busy and they're very important. But actually, it's our lives and we have to stand up. So if you have, take a bit of time, look at one of the booklets under the resources section, listen to a few podcasts, download the app. There's so much information on it. Mm-hmm. And then push back with your doctor and say, why aren't you giving me HRT? Because I know the guidelines are there saying it's safe.
Yeah.
You don't have to come and see a private doctor to get HRT. You shouldn't have to. It should be available by from the NHS. And anyone can quote me. You know, I'm a proper doctor. I'm a menopause specialist. I'm a fellow of the Royal College of GP. Yeah. I'm not a scam doctor. And I'm also, I don't get paid by any HRT making companies. Just to put that there.
I want to say to a few people like Jane, just we have put a link. There's lots of people. I think there's somebody from your practice putting up your link, but you'll see that on it. And we will put it at the end. We are going to save this. It will be on Facebook. We will also make a shorter film, put it on Instagram, and we will have it on YouTube. So it will be widely available. Do not worry. Just a few more comments here to reiterate. Coming through, Margaret, age 64, was told by her GP that she was over 60, so she couldn't go on HRT. I'd say, Margaret, push back. Go back, see another doctor in your practice, and maybe download the app. And if an app is beyond you, just listen to this 3 or 4 times, write down some notes, and then go and ask again. And I think it's just that thing, Louise, you said just now so eloquently about, you know, it's showing of a love of ourselves that we want to take care of ourselves, and we want to not brush things under the carpet and actually address these issues and be in control of our bodies.
It's really important. And the other thing is don't be afraid to ask for a second opinion. You know, we are human beings as healthcare professionals. We're not robots. We get things wrong. And we don't know everything. Yeah. So if someone comes to me and I don't know the answer, I'll say, look, I don't know the answer, but I'll tell you who does, or go and see this person. Some doctors won't do that. They'll pretend and they'll say, oh, no, you can't have it. Well, actually, if you know you can, or you want some different advice, then just go and see someone else. And the doctor is not going to lose sleep that their patient's seen 2, 3, 3-4 other doctors. It's your choice. So it's really important that you don't feel intimidated. It, you know, as doctors, we can't play God. We shouldn't be paternalistic. We should be empowering our patients, and the consultation should be led by our patients.
Yeah. I think also, we, you know, some people have a difficult time with the British doctor. There are people here, there's a lady in Turkey saying they won't even discuss it with the doctor. You know, there's certain countries where women are incredibly disadvantaged still to be
able to. This is something that the charity, so the Menopause Charity, wants to address. We want to help disadvantaged women. And there are lots of women globally from certain ethnic minorities where they're not allowed to talk about the menopause. They don't have a word for the menopause.
Yeah.
They just have to put up with their symptoms in the Middle East, and you can't even get HRT. What's that about? Why can't we have our replacement hormones? It's really, really important.
Yeah.
You know, women are dropping like flies. About a fifth of women leave their jobs because of the symptoms of mood problems, of memory problems, anxiety, fatigue. You know, we have
a huge statistic. A fifth of people, that's a huge statistic.
Massive. It's absolutely massive. And, you know, we know we did a study recently of some GPs in the UK, and 38% had symptoms that were affecting them at work and wanting to change their work. You know, I couldn't work as a GP if I wasn't taking HRT. There's no way. I couldn't remember anything.
I mean, there's people now coming on. I think there's a lot of people joining, Louise, because we're still out. But just... people saying, why take HRT? So without going back to the beginning, I want to say, please replay this, because Louise very eloquently talks about why take it, why our levels of hormones go down as we age, and why it's good to support our structure, our body, and prevent illness through taking HRT, which is a big thing you said. For those people who live abroad, who want to have a greater understanding, the two main things we've discussed are: the app is called Balance, Louise.
Yes, it's called Balance.
And so, download it from the App Store.
Yeah, or Google Play.
And what's your colour of the icon so people can quickly see
it? Oh, here you go. Here's the colour. There you go.
Balance. Okay, there it is. Great. And also hormonedoctor.co.uk.
No, Menopause Doctor.
Right, I'm so sorry. Menopausedoctor.co.uk, which it will have Lily. All the information, Louise, you have so kindly been discussing and sharing with us today. But I can't thank you enough. I think that...
Thank you for inviting me.
We've tried to get through lots of comments, but there are still thousands of comments coming on. And I don't know if you have a member of your team who can also look with our team through these comments just to give a little bit more.
We can help. But there's a lot of information. It's all free on the app, on the website. And then the Menopause Charity website is themenopausecharity.org.
Yep.
So the more we can help each other, the more we can move forward. Definitely.
Yeah, and the Balance app might just be on the UK Apple Store.
No, it's worldwide.
It's on the US as well. So the lady in the US, you can go to the Apple Store on your phone and download the Balance app. Brilliant.
Yeah.
So great. I mean, we could do this, Louise, like once every few weeks. You know, each time we'll catch more women. And I know that your mission in life,
absolutely,
educate women around how they can live a wonderful life and get through menopause with joy.
Absolutely. It's so important. With joy and being healthy as well.
Exactly. Being healthy. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks.
That was lovely. And thank you, everybody, for watching. And we will hopefully get another session in with Louise in a month or so, because I think that we could continue to have this conversation for hours. The app is called Balance on the App Store, and it's Menopause, and there's also menopausecharity.org. There's different ones, but the one that we've been mentioning is menopause.co.uk. Now, yes, I mean, we can go into lots of comments here, but I'm going to stop with the comments because there's now flying through even more, and we'll catch up soon. Thank you very much. All right.